Good evening, ladies and gentlemen. Thanks for your participation. We are on the third day. This is the third session of this series. It's a very small subject, as everyone sees, but very exhaustive. Even today, I could not able to complete because what we are going to see as case studies or case law references, it's very huge. Maybe you'll know that this is not being practiced in many establishments in a wide range. But irrespective of that, the cases are mounting in every other court. Though not many cases are being reported by the women employees, or maybe it is not being inquired properly. So many things are there. Irrespective of that, the visibility of this particular legislation is very high. So, the subject wise, and I have more and more inputs. That's why I could able to divide this into three areas. One is awareness, cognizance of POSH provisions, where who's obligated for what, for a smooth and safe work environment. That's what we were actually looking in the first session. Yesterday, it was a session on how to constitute challenges in constituting the internal committee and the assignments, accountability of the internal committee. So many things like the seriousness of an internal committee, how sensitive it is, what is the right combination of internal committee and external committee members. So that can be seen in the court cases, honorable judgments by the High Court and the Supreme Court, honorable Supreme Court and honorable High Court judgments. What we are going to see, I've selected very few, but irrespective of that, it is very huge. Hopefully, I will restrict only, I will show everything, I will share everything, but we will discuss only one or two cases here. That's what today what we are going to do is we are going to discuss case studies, FAQ. I am not going to discuss in detail because FAQ means everybody wants to know what is sexual harassment and basic questions which we were discussing yesterday and day before yesterday. I do not want to repeat each and everything again and again. So I have selected very few FAQs which is not discussed yesterday, or maybe which is not relevant which is more relevant for today's discussion, things like that. And few case laws, and before that, the queries raised by the participants, like you, whoever has raised during registration, that we are discussing. I've comprehended all the queries into single questions, and I'm answering that. So I think yes, we have some 5 participants. Let us move on, because I do not want to waste time, because I wanted to do justice to those who are joined in time. We will be discussing now. You can I allow you to know, because this is a webinar session, I do not know how can I take questions, but you can chat. I think you can type whatever your queries on each case, then I will read out and I will reply also. Each case studies, I will tell you what is that and what is the answer. And now I am disconnecting the video because of net connectivity will go slow. And the names, whatever has been mentioned in the case studies, it is imaginary. It is not depicting or representing any individuals. It is not in my mind. It's like, in one case, my name is also there. So it's like, just like that is given. Nothing like that. It is a disclaimer here. I am not identifying any individual over here. Okay, we'll go with the case studies. Okay, the first case study what we are going to discuss is a manager shouts at his subordinate for not performing poor performance in front of others, whether this is a sexual harassment or not. Yes, we have very recently seen a case study, judgment, which very clearly states that no, it is not. If it is for getting work done, definitely no. It is not going to be sexual harassment. It was very clearly stated that to get work done, it is not a, maybe if the female feels harassed, she can go and complain to the HR. That's all. More than that, it is not a sexual harassment. We are discussing on sexual harassment only. Employee A intimate to women employee B having physical touches with consent and allowed exception. So the female employee allows everything. They're very friendly. She doesn't mind the person touching her, maybe back or maybe the shoulder or something like that, to stand closer. So it is allowed exception and with the consent of the female employee. So here also, it is not a sexual harassment. So during the complaint itself, the internal committee can reject this as not a sexual harassment. And they cannot treat this as a sexual harassment as it is. We'll go to the next case study. A women subordinate has to officially visit the cabin of her boss, who displays image of his favorite actress in swimsuit. So it is a cabin, male boss, women subordinate is visiting the cabin frequently. If something like a backdrop or a screensaver or any book or magazine, something like that, it is on the table or a desktop or something like that, you know, it is displayed, it will be a discomfort for that women employee. It is a sexual harassment. A colleague, in the name of unwinding de-stress himself, often listens to item song. So it is nothing like, you know, maybe in Indian cinemas, you know, and people dances and there some double meaning words will be there, something like that. So a person can listen to any song provided if the establishment allows to use such audio or video inside the office. Provided it should not disturb others. Maybe if a person wants to listen to it, they can put it on the not on the speaker, a headphone, and they can he can listen to it. If it is going to be disturbing the women employee, this kind of a song, an ordinary song, it is an harassment. If it is going to be something like this with a double meaning, things like that, it considers a sexual harassment. It can be very easily taken up as a sexual harassment. The problem here is, you know, this kind of a small complaint comes, then it will be like the punishment will be kind of reprimanding or issuing a show cause notice, transferring the person, things like that. It will not be a major punishment, but it will be a punishment. But the employer should be very careful in taking such immediate action on such things so that it will not recur, or also it will not embolden the other male members. So the others will not feel that, okay, I can target this lady because she is adjusting for anything and everything. Or maybe the other person will say, that section it is happening, why not in this section? That department is allowing everything, why not in this department? So employer has to treat this as a kind of a sexual harassment. Employee A, male manager, offers his subordinate female employee a coffee out. So it is not a dating, it is a coffee out. She rejects. No more assignments, project work for her by her boss. So he maybe or may not, you know, he had requested for a coffee out, not inside the office, but she rejected. So she has every right to reject. Inside the office, if it is during a discussion, maybe she can say that she may not enjoy coffee, she may be available for the discussion. But asking her to come out is her personal request. She can always reject. If it is there, and if it ends with that, if she rejects, then there is no sexual harassment. But after that, that male manager does not give any assignment or project or work, then it will be considered as a sexual harassment. Same scenario, he was very polite, And after that, she's rejecting it. And then she gets normal work. Both are normal. So he also understood that she doesn't want to be like this. And it become normal. Then in these cases, it is not a sexual harassment. Next one. Karthi and Kala, I already told that I am not mentioning any name. Just like that, I picked a name. Karthi and Kala from different departments met each other in one of the full day training program. So they are from different departments. They met in the training program. During lunch, seeing Kala's expertise, Karthi offered to take her into his team. Kala is female, Karthi is male. Asked her to share the profile. Kala is excited with a new role and joined Karthi's team. So they just like that met in a training program of the same, working in the same organization. And she was shifted to Karthi's team. Few days later, Karthi asked Kala out for dinner a few times and she agreed willingly. After some time, due to work pressure or other reasons, when Karthi asked for such a request, Kala refused. Karthi was insisting that she obliged to hear, meaning that, you know, because Karthi identified the skills of Kala, he only recommended and posted, and she also was growing in the new segment department. Kala refused strictly and kept their relationship professional. That this is what is required from every female employee in an organization. Karthi still doesn't agree even after she said sorry stop from Kala. If in this situation, what Karthi is doing is a sexual harassment. Whoever wants to raise any question, please raise question in the chat box. I can read. The next case study, Sridhar sent across pictures of some scantily clad women to Jyoti. Jyoti is a female, Sridhar is a male. Jyoti requested Sridhar not to send him such obscene pictures in future as she was not comfortable with the same. Sridhar stopped it. So that is the end. There, it was stopped and no more recurrence and everything is stopped. Nothing has happened. It became a normal. No more complaints. No sexual harassment complaint. Julie was taking official bus to go to office. John walked with Deepa. So John, male walking with another girl, tapped Julie on her back and told her how hot she looked in her dress. Julie felt uncomfortable and looked at John disapprovingly. So here also, this female employee saying, stop, this is the limit. He disapproves. He felt very bad and also happened in front of another girl. So Julie asked him to keep his hands off her and use discretion in his language. John apologized and never talks to her. So here, very purely it is a sexual harassment, where it is a discomfort to Julie and she disapproves it, and John apologized immediately. Julie could have taken up a complaint, but she was magnanimous enough. She is not taking up the case, and after that, nothing has happened. But in case it has been taken as a sexual harassment, yes, it is a sexual harassment. We'll move to the next case study. Pradeepa is an intern who has just finished her academics and joined the organization. During her internship, the team leader calls her to his cabin and tells her about the specific assignment he's planning to assign to. So the team leader tells Deepa that, okay, you being an intern, I will give you a special assignment. Then you can even have more privileges post the internship. Pradeepa is delighted at the thought. Team leader suggested her to accompany him to his farmhouse over the weekend, but was politely refused by Pradeepa. So because it is nothing but quid pro quo, I give this, I want to take something, this for that, something like that. But the team leader was threatening not to offer the on-site assignment to her. So initially, he offered on-site assignment, expecting quid pro quo, but as she refused, he also rejected things like that. If Pradeepa takes up these two IC, then it will be treated as a sexual harassment. Anandan is a manager and leads a team of 15 people. He holds daily huddle with his team in the morning. At the start of every meeting, he encourages his team to share jokes. See, in few companies it is happening. Every day morning there will be a huddle. People will start together before they resume to their regular work. They discuss something. It could be what is happening outside, whether something impacting their business, something like that. Or maybe some days they will be very fun day, entertainment, things like that. So sometimes, each person will give something. The manager always talks something, but most of the time it is double meanings. He being the manager representing, he creates a hostile environment. It is a double meaning. Many of other employees, male or female, accept it. But Sudha did not accept it. That's why she is coming late. Just to avoid the initial joke session, she doesn't like it. She comes late. So the manager Anandan insisted that everyone is required. It is like a general talk. He was telling that in a generic way. Everyone should come in time for adult without excuses, stating that she is avoiding something. But the actual reason for her avoidance is discomfort due to the manager's talk, which is a double meaning. That is sexual harassment. When Sudha explained her situation, he told that she lacks sense of humor. Here, please see that yesterday and day before yesterday, we were talking about intent and the impact. We were talking about this intent of the person. So the manager was thinking that when I talk something like this, people will laugh. They'll be venting out and they'll be very easy. And the day started afresh. But the impact on that particular employee, something different. So here, the intent and impact was. So these are all the things which is not there in the provisions of law, things like that. This only happens through experience and when people should be mindful what is happening, whether the IC committee or the management or the HR whoever takes care, should be very mindful what is happening in the office, why there is no smooth safe play, atmosphere is not there, things like that. These are all things will always happen. People always say that the senior management people, if some group discussion is happening, a review meeting is happening, the senior management person to come as an incognito mode. Somebody will join, nobody will know that who has joined, and something like that. They have to monitor the situation inside the office only to ensure smooth and safe atmosphere inside the office. This is what is required in any office. So here it's very clear. The intent is something different, the impact is something different. Yeah, next case study. Women employee A recommended her friend who studied with her. He joined other project. Okay, I think this is a repetition. He joined in other project in the same company. So a women employee recommended her male friend who studied with her. He joined in project of the same company. After he joined, both went together for a coffee break, lunch. So, see, because they studied both, she joined the company first and she recommended, and through recommendation, he also joined, but not on the same project, different project. Irrespective of being the different project, they go together for a coffee break, lunch. After lunch, there will be a chatting in every office. They go together and every office knows this, and through CCTV monitoring also, even the management knows that. Irrespective of that, deliverables are not getting affected. So nobody had questioned their relationship, whether it's a very close relationship or just like a friend relationship, nobody questioned it. One fine day, and also they leave the office together after work, whether they go in the same vehicle or a different vehicle, that is different. So this is to state that they are very intimate, because she recommended this guy and this guy is also joined. They were very close in the vicinity of the entire office. One fine day, both went out during lunch break. This is the case today I was telling in the first session. One fine day, both went out during a lunch break. So went out, but please be very careful. In the first para itself, I have told lunch is provided freely at the office. Everybody can have lunch at the office itself. But they went out. For some reason, they went out. Maybe for lunch or something else. So they went out during a lunch break, hopefully for a lunch outside. Within a few minutes, the women employee came directly to the IC member chair and made a sexual harassment complaint. Here, it is very clear. I'll take some few minutes time here. Maybe we'll put others also in other slides. So I'll take more time here. Here, when this case come, not an hypothetical situation. This is a case reported. The IC committee initially was reluctant to take the case because one thing they have to see whether he's an aggrieved human, yes or no, is not decided. He's an employee, but the workplace is outside. Okay, workplace is outside, but whether it is an extended workplace or not. See, if both went out for lunch, officially sponsored lunch or any other official work, and there they took lunch, or maybe here I mentioned as a lunch, maybe they went out, they have not went out officially during lunchtime, where it is a statutory interval period. Statutorily, somebody has to give half an hour to 1 hour period. That time they went out. Something happened outside. It is definitely not a workplace. And it is not officially sponsored also. Even if it is a lunch or any other meeting, it is not officially sponsored. So the workplace is not office. The workplace is not an extended office. So the IC rejected, just like that, stating that it can be a sexual harassment. Maybe they have not probed into details. What has happened, whether he pulled or maybe talked something nonsense or something like that, hit or physically, nobody knows, but it has not happened inside the workplace. Maybe during working hours, but not inside the premises. So the IC, just like that, after a deep discussion, they rejected this and stated that this will not come under sexual harassment, they will not enter into the company. So these are all small nuances. Somebody has to see whether this can be treated as a sexual harassment, whether this is a workplace, whether they can take up the complaint, and if they have taken up the complaint, what she has to do hereafter. She has to only go for appeal. Appeal, maybe management will not take up. She has to go outside. That's all. So this is very, very specific case where the nuances of the sexual harassment, the definition which is mentioned in the provisions of the Act. So somebody has to be very, very careful in taking up the complaint. A very classic example. We'll go to the next case study. So this is about remote working. Very recently, I also attended this session, counseling session. Many women employees felt that their managers do not have basic courtesy of limiting review meetings, client calls before 8 p.m. See, irrespective of whether they work from home, paid for this or not, you have to respect the privacy of definitely a women employee. She is at home, surrounded with the family. Other domestic chores are also there. So it is a review meeting. It is not a client call or any project deliverables is due, something like that. A review meeting. Client calls, okay. If it is a US client or UK client, time difference is different, something like that. But if a local client also, they want to discuss something with the women employee, if she accepts, okay. Otherwise, you cannot insist a women employee to disturb every time after 8 o'clock, 9 o'clock in the evening. While she is at home, apart from exceptional cases, many complaints were received, starting that the male managers who commented that if women employees cannot perform such duties as men at home, they oblige every meeting, and even at midnight, 11 o'clock, 12 o'clock, they claim that I'm working very hard, things like that. The male managers tell that they can resign and restrict themselves to home kitchen. This should not happen. This is this displays the culture of the organization. No individual can comment on the other person like this. If they can do some work, they can do. If they cannot do, they can tell. They cannot tell that, you know, I am working, the other person also work. That is the management decision whether the other person is obliged to do, because there is a working time. Even if you work at home, you are controlled with the labor laws. Further remarks passed on the women employees include during the remote working, remarks during the discussions, no, on the costumes, cloth they are wearing during the meeting. No women likes that. Remarks about the surrounding. That's why yesterday I very clearly told, you know, when women employees are attending video calls, don't put on video and switch off. Remarks about the surrounding, sofa, lighting, dark, bright. You can imagine what kind of a person wants to comment, what kind of a comment that they will make. Comments about the siblings or other persons in the house, about timings, what will be doing at this time if you are working at office, came back at home, things like that. These were all complaints from the women employees. They should reflect, they should not reflect any organization. It's very bad culture. This will definitely attract sexual harassment. Employers' responsibility has increased sizably after remote working started. To address these challenges through continuous awareness sessions by stakeholding managers. There cannot be any control, but the individuals can be taught, educated how to behave on a remote work. Senior management people should involve themselves in some discussion to oversee incognito. That's what I was mentioning, incognito, to see the conversation. Each discussion shall be recorded and perused by the senior management. So this also is required. We'll go to the next slide. Okay, this is another case. A client was a foreigner. We used to regularly visit the service provider office, that is inside the India. Once behaved in a way which was felt as a sexual harassment by the women employee. So the what actually has happened is the foreigner who came to India, the male foreigner, he came to the office where the service provider's office. There he went and directly congratulated for the good work they are doing, and this person hugged the person, hugged the lady in Indian office. At that time, nothing has happened. Everybody was cool. Okay, it was a congratulation. So we have done a very good project. We completed the project happily, things like that. But somebody took a photo and put it in a Facebook, and the family of the women employee saw this and they were little upset. And the women employee realized that, and she went to the IC, the case to the IC, stating that I feel this as a sexual harassment. It is a sexual harassment. It is a discomfort. It is not an allowed one. He suddenly came. The Western culture, hugging is an allowed and a normal. In Indian culture, it is not allowed. The management intervened after she gave the complaint. Management amicably settled the matter as they felt that client is most important. The biggest business project comes from that client, and taking such cases to the client will be difficult. They may not get business, and the management cajoled and controlled the women employee, told that you can freely involve into more projects. We will give free hand to do so many things. You can grow with the organization. And they assured that there is no recurrence will happen. And see that any foreigner who comes to our company will be made known of the Indian culture. What they should do, if they can handshake only with the male, that is also not allowed now after COVID. Maybe they cannot, the female employee says, okay, then they can shake hands, things like that. So the culture will be, see, these are all kind of an atmosphere every establishment has to start giving to every employee, male or a female or a visitor. So many things are involved. The employer felt that the client who is a foreigner do not understand the culture of our country. He assured that the management will take appropriate measures to educate the visiting clients from other countries, make them aware of the culture in India. So she withdrew the complaint and it was amicably settled. This is what is the case. Okay, one more. This is very specific. It was raised to me by one of my previous client, and she was asking me over phone. in our branch office, we usually have annual day celebration every year to coincide with the Holi. On such day, all family members of our employees will be invited to office. So family members of employees will come to the office and will be sharing a get together. It is to show cause to the family that atmosphere in the employees, where they are working, how they are being taken care, things like that. So as usual, there are fun programs followed by a dinner for all. So this is regular, usual, every year it happens. But this year they have received a complaint. This happened last Holi. We received a complaint of sexual harassment from a women participant who is a family member of employee. See, very clearly you can see this is a workplace. It happened in the office, in the workplace. Aggrieved woman is a woman. So not necessarily she has to be a women employee. Aggrieved woman, a family member of an employee against a man who is also a family member of another employee. Something has happened. She wants to make a complaint. Here, she very much qualifies that she is an aggrieved woman in a workplace. Something has happened. Officially sponsored program. Where the definition of woman is any woman at the workplace, we need to consider sexual harassment complaint under POSH Act. But the respondent male being non-employee, how to proceed with the complaint was the query. So the solution is very, very significant, but a little complicated. The only solution available before them is to going to enforcement agency like police, because they cannot take action on a male respondent who is not an employee. They can take action only on an employee. They can, employees relation. So as per section of 19H of the Act, I told that there is no provision in the Act to direct the respondent male who is not an employee to attend the inquiry, and the internal committee has no powers to take action. So what they can do is the employer only can facilitate the women to go to the police and file a case against the person who was seems to be harassed, sexually harassed or whatever. The police will take the case. I am going into a few FAQs. These FAQs being regularly asked, and from the registration, one of the participants also asked this. Our headcount is 12 and we do not have female employee. Somebody has raised a question. Yes, I'll take the question. What in case if the women employee harass an external male in a family function? Yes, if a women employee harassed by external male employee, external male in family function. So, no, here the same thing happens here. What in case if the women employee harassed by external male? See, external male, the employer or the IC cannot take any action. The external means the employer can facilitate a women employee again to go to the police only. Because on that external male, what the employer can take action? The person, the male is working in the organization, they can take show cause issue, show cause notice, demote or cut the increment. So many things are there. Yesterday we discussed, so many are there, or terminate or do anything. But here, the respondent accused is not working in the organization. So IC has no power. Only as per the IPC section, they can go and register with the police. So our headcount is 12 and we do not have female employee. Do we need to constitute IC? How? Yes, it is mandatory if the strength is 10 or more. If you do not have female employees, check whether you can have someone from your group organization, else complaints, if any, is to be given to the local committee. Yesterday, we have exhaustive listers shared who are all the local committees. The next FAQ, whether the external member should be advocate or only female, or what is the qualification? This is repeatedly been asked by every establishment. He or she, that's why immediately I'm saying he or she, it can be male or a female, cannot be mandatorily by legal, mandatorily a legal professional. But yesterday in my session, I very clearly suggested that if there is no legal professional in the internal committee, better you have a external person who's having some legal knowledge. It is to draft the recommendations, the help, if somebody goes on appeal. You can have either male or female. He or she may be an advocate or a person familiar with the women issues or women activists or from an NGO, things like that. There is no restriction that they can have anyone. But I will show you some court cases, how the honorable courts have very clearly ordered what has to be observed, what has to be there. Do we have to have IC for each branch location? Yes, yesterday we have discussed. If you don't have people over there, you can have the same IC in the other branches also, but have one more local person. It will facilitate you to take up any cases. Who all can make a complaint? Aggrieved women. If a person is there, the aggrieved women, women employee or a visitor or whoever it is, or a relative, colleague, friend, officer of a National Commission for Women or a State Commission for Women, or any person who has the knowledge of such incident, this after or whatever I had mentioned, if the aggrieved woman is physically incapacitated to give complaint, otherwise the aggrieved woman only has to give. In case of mental incapacity of the women, other than the above, the special educator or any physician attending, psychometrist or psychologist, whoever is attending, they can also give. But in case of any death, death happened after physical assault, sexual assault, something like that, legal or only can give a sexual harassment case. Anyway, they will go to the police also. Here also they can go and give the complaint. Can the women make simultaneous complaint to police under IPC? Yes. If male employee is sexually harassed, what to do? This can be taken up in, I think, gender neutral is the word is repeatedly being used in many companies. That too, US, UK companies, MNCs started using gender neutral. We are gender neutral. So, yes, it is being tried out. Tried in the sense, the complaint has been taken, things are happening. But IC has no power. IC is not there. Maybe you can have an ethics committee. They have people called ethics committee. Or maybe HR may be taking care, things like that. Yes, a male also can be sexually harassed. We have many cases reported, but IC cannot take, internal committee, as under the Sexual Harassment Act, no. But this can be taken up by HR department, management. Management can decide our code on ethics, HR policy, under anything they can take up. Many participants asked queries. Woman gave a complaint but later withdrawn. What will IC do? Okay. If the reasons are genuine, yeah, IC can do. Okay. They can allow. Okay. You take. But if it is under pressure, or maybe pressure from management, or pressure from the employee, or pressure from the colleague, or pressure from the family stating that why you want to take all such risks? Why this is very difficult? This will again come out in the news later. He may go up. Many things will happen. We are going here to earn some money. You should not get disturbed by these things. You just forget. If this, under this kind of a pressure, if she withdraws, how IC will know? They have to probe. They have to talk. They have to counsel the women employee why she has given in the first instance, and then why she is withdrawing it, things like that. And they can allow the petition to be withdrawn. Definitely, a withdrawal of the petition has to be recorded, physical written letter. Else, if it is due to pressure, they can continue the case. They have to continue because IC has the accountability to have the case continue. Interim relief of paid leave. For example, IC decided that the complaint is true and the case is taken up, and the women employee is pressurized, so they are giving leave, 1 month leave, 2 months leave, things like that. There is an interim relief is given, but the respondent is not accused, and the petition was not rejected, but it was seen as a malicious. So the two different things. If it is the person is accused, yes, the paid leave can be as it is paid leave. But the answer, if the complaint is rejected for the reason want of more evidence or documentation, leave cannot be withdrawn. So it was only rejected. It was not stated that it is a malicious complaint. But in case if the complaint is malicious, payment towards leave can be deducted from the future salary. So it is a malicious complaint. It is a wrongful application of complaint, and then she was given leave, so that money can be taken back, deducted from her future salary. As an employer, can I stop or say that I will not assist if the aggrieved woman wants to give a complaint? So employer, women aggrieved woman wants to give a police complaint simultaneously, and the employer says no, you cannot give, or I will not facilitate. Both they should not do. It is a employer duty to facilitate, and they should not stop her making on her own or facilitating. So the management needs to abide by the recommendation of the IC. As I gave an example, in one case management has amicably settled the things. So if something goes on appeal, it is up to the management to take up. Usually management will oblige whatever the recommendation has been given. But here also many times they will see whether the reputation of the individual, many things, they may condone some punishment, things like that. So management usually take decision. It is only a recommendation from the IC committee. Internal committee. I did not had sex with an employee. This is a stupid question. Irrespective of that, whether it is stupid or not, this is being repeatedly raised by many male participants during my training. I did not had sex. He was talking about the physical sex with the employee. Why I am being punished under this legislation? The act is very clear. Any act or behavior which has a sexual intention, sexual nature, anything related to sexual act or behavior, I was telling here, even a whistling, the sexual harassment. Winking of eyes, that's also a sexual harassment. Treat as a sexual harassment under this act. Who can go on appeal against the employer order? Both. For example, aggrieved women, if something is rejected, I told one case, it was rejected by IC. She can go for an appeal. In one case, the punishment was only a show cause. The aggrieved woman wants to go for a higher punishment. She can go for an appeal. Things like that. So it is in her favor. He was punished. Irrespective of that, she wanted to go for an appeal. Respondent also can go for an appeal. Next question, last one is, can aggrieved women or respondent appoint advocates in this legislation? No, nobody can represent aggrieved women or respondent. What is the immediate action that a woman can take when she is encountered with sexual harassment at workplace? And will the issue be sorted out at the organizational level or will it be escalated to judicial bodies? The answer is she has to complain to the internal committee. This question is raised by a participant. It should be considered only at the organizational level. She can go for appeal in upper judicial forum. Please understand, internal committee itself has a judicial power. In upper judicial forum, only if the solution provided is not accepted by her, whether it is favor or not favor, it is not acceptable and she is going for an appeal. How to ensure that the accused in the top management is also penalized under POSH Act if found guilty of the charge by another participant? This has happened. Aggrieved woman has to complain to the IC, which has a judicial power, and it has to inquire without any bias. I'm sorry for the typo. Any bias and recommend the punishment to the management. Management has to take. This has happened. Many top management people have been punished under the POSH Act. For instance, on a virtual meeting, participants were privy to poster on the wall with provocation content that caused discomfort to the participant. Is it POSH? How should we handle the situation? Yes, it is. We have extensively discussed this one yesterday and today also. It is a sexual harassment. A complaint can be immediately raised by the women employee. If somebody has taken a screenshot, that itself is enough. How we can effectively implement the POSH policy across different works unit in a service industry. Question from another participant. It is only through continuous awareness session, definitely repeated awareness for both male and female. Treat sexual harassment as a misconduct and punish immediately. Disciplinary actions are taken regularly. Develop the internal committee with the new capabilities. Now, we are discussing so many things, so many different types of case studies. Now, somebody has to develop an internal committee. It cannot be, as we were discussing yesterday, like internal committee are pick and choose from the management, like the one person is the senior most women, whether she knows something or not, is from admin department or purchase department or from operation department, they pick and appoint. But it is not an issue, but they have to develop the new capabilities to handle such situations. So new things are coming. In any organization nowadays, it is not the old same people are there. Millennials are joining. Millennials are maybe, the new generation people. They have a different type of attitude. Things are always happen in a different way, unexpected way. I'm not taking it the right way or wrong way, unexpected way. Running an organization is so difficult with such a mix of cultures, belief, things like that. That also we discussed the day before yesterday. So new capabilities have to be developed for the internal company. They also repeatedly need to be trained. Specific posh facts, only women can sexually harass. We have seen it is not that. This is a myth. Men also can be subjected, but it cannot be treated under this act. They can raise a complaint with HR, harassment committee, or ethic committee. I have a question here. Sir, can you please share PPT? I am prepared, maybe. Please wait for 2 more days. Tomorrow I have a big client discussion. So maybe Sunday I will try to send it, or by Monday, whoever participated on all 3 days will get all 3. Women enjoy being commented on. No, this is a myth. No women will enjoy if she is commented, just like that. Casual looking of bodies is natural. I understand, but it will be treated as a sexual harassment. Just casually looking at her eyes, looking at her face, okay. No more gestures and don't look down. See, it is very easy to say, but it is very difficult. This is what is your attitude. It is a sexual harassment. Please be very careful. Physical fight subsequent quarrel. So if men and women, individual men and women are fighting, and there's a physical touch, but it is a physical fighting. It is not treated after a quarrel. But there, in such cases, it is not treated as a sexual harassment. Okay, we will be moving into the next case study, last case study, I believe. An allegation is against a person who is a senior to the preceding officer, or the lady is a preceding officer. The preceding officer is reporting to the senior person. It's a case study from Honorable Allahabad High Court. So in my opinion, there is nothing in the scheme of the section which requires a lady member to be senior in rank to the officer against whom the allegation sexual harassment. The language of Section 4 Act only requires a lady member to the senior level. So it is not that, what the judgment order is very, very clear is, there is no requirement that only senior most person can be there as a preceding officer. Wherever in an organization, there is only 2 or 3 people. And within that 2 or 3 people, whoever is the senior most, she can be only be appointed. So there is no restriction for the presiding officer to either conduct an inquiry, or it is illegal for such committee to proceed with the inquiry having the same presiding officer. Irrespective of whether the person who is accused, the respondent is senior most, to whom the presiding officer reporting, the case can continue, he can try the case. That's why the last point is very, very clear. Let the final report, because it should not be like biased, or it should not be prepared. She felt afraid, what will happen to my rating if I find the complaint is true and I give a recommendation. So let the final report of such inquiry being submitted to the management have concrete and considerable contribution by the external member of the internal committee. This is more sensitive. That's why we wanted external members are also very strong, with more legislative background, and they are not attached to the organization. They don't know who is who. They will not know this person is presiding officer's reporting manager. She will just like that, or he will just like that, give a report stating that whether it is true or not. This will speak in any of the higher forum, so that it should be very, very cautious in appointing the external person in the interest of internal committee and the organization. Okay, I think we have only another 10 minutes time. What I will do, I have some another 10 slides. I'm not definitely going to the details of all 10. This is all case law references. So with that, we are going to finish, but I am not going through all case law references. I am going to share it to you. You can go through all case law references. Maybe if you wanted to see, the first line is Delhi High Court, whom versus whom. That is there. If you type that, you can get a judgment itself. In few cases, I have tagged to what actually is the reason. For example, I'll tell you the next slide. The first one I tagged it to how IC can be constituted. Things like that. That also very easy for you to refer. So what I will do is with these slides, I have highlighted in each slide one case I have highlighted. So one case, Honorable Delhi High Court, Anita Suresh versus Union of India. See, here I would like to mention very clearly, until the case was with the internal committee or within the campus of the organization, premises of the organization, it is highly confidential. Once it has come to the higher judicial forum, it is open to all. Where if it is having a bad or good reflection on the establishment. That's why this act itself is very, very sensitive act legislation. So in some cases, we are going to see in some cases, the fine, the penalty levied on the organization is very huge. Apart from the bad reputation, reputational assault, monetarily also the organizations are losing. So this act is very, very sensitive. This has not taken up its wing across India in other organization or every organization, because it is limited. Just very recently it started coming out. By the time COVID also came, now in even during remote working, the complaints are just like that being coming up. So every establishment will be very, very careful in complying with the provisions of this act. The first one, Honorable Delhi High Court, Anita Suresh versus Union of India and others, a hefty fine of rupees 50,000 was slapped on a woman for filing a frivolous sexual harassment claim against a senior. This is a malicious complaint. So maybe the internal committee would have rejected, stating that this is a malicious complaint or any other complaint. But when she, maybe you, she would have, I have not gone into detail, she would have gone on for an appeal for something, but here he was slapped with the 50,000 rupees fine. So this also you have to see. I have one more question has come. You can take more time in case law if you can. Okay, I'll take definitely. Serious cases I believe will discuss anyway. Even discussing one or two cases itself is taking time. In this slide, I have two different specific cases. Delhi High Court, Ruchika Singh. I think Honorable Delhi High Court has taken so many sexual harassment cases. I think their people, they have many, many institutions. They and in NCR region, in Delhi High Court, though there are no big industries, but other offices, many offices, government institutions are there. So so many cases are going for appeal. So Honorable Delhi High Court came out with many such judgments. In Ruchika Singh Chabra versus Mrs. Air France India and another, external member does not only have to be independent, but also must have expertise in issues related to sexual harassment. This is what I had mentioned repeatedly. He or she should know what is sexual harassment, why something has happened, whether that is a sexual harassment, what is the intent, what is the impact. So many things are there. The other one, Honorable Delhi High Court, Manjeet Singh versus Indraprastha Gas Limited. The person against whom a complaint of sexual harassment has been filed must be presumed. That's what. So, if there is a case on me, I am not immediately convicted. Like what media trial is doing in so many cases, I should not be convicted immediately. That's what the case was very clearly mentioned. Presumed. The accused, respondent, delinquent, he is working in your organization. Because of just one piece of paper, something is written and given to him, that the big stature of that individual person should not come down immediately, and he should be presumed that he is accused. It has to be found out by the internal committee with all documentation, evidences. Until such time, that's what this judgment states, that he should be presumed to be innocent until there is an evidence to show otherwise. Very, very simply said, it is equally important that the goodwill, fair name, dignity of an innocent accused, until he was proved with that complaint, he was innocent. Accused to be dealt with. At most, care and dignity of neither party can be trifled with inquiry proceedings. A very clear judgment, observation given by Honorable Delhi High Court. The another case, Honorable Delhi High Court, Gaurav Jain versus Hindustan Latex Family Planning Promotion Trust and others. Honorable Court upheld the decision of the employer to terminate employment of the accused in line with the recommendation of internal committee, where the accused was alleged to have sexually harassed a female colleague during an outstation visit for work. Clean. So the punishment given after the sexual harassment proved is dismissal, termination. So it was allowed by the Honorable High Court. They cannot plead against the Honorable High Court that this is the highest punishment. Please consider revision of a dismissal. I can be reinstated with some other punishment. No, the Honorable High Court says no. Even termination can be given. See, such a people are feeling that it is a very, very small. What is there? What is sexual harassment in happening? It is happening across everything. But how the courts are feeling? That's what it is. Government is very, very sensitive. They can only regulate, put more and more provisions in the law, things like that. And the judiciary is also very cautious, watchdog, what is happening. When cases are coming up, they are doing their best. But the establishment are open so that the ultimate aim of this act is to provide a safe working place for women. Very simply that, because it took so long for the government to come up with the case, the act and the rules after some 10, more than 10 years. It is so difficult. The establishment are not complying with the act nowadays. Okay, next slide. Okay, in Honorable Bombay High Court, Sapna Korde ni Ketaki A. Godinde was a state of Maharashtra and others. Filing a complaint against a person belonging to scheduled caste or scheduled tribe does not constitute to atrocity against under Scheduled Caste and Scheduled Tribe Act 1989, unless such complaint is prima facie proved to be false, malicious. Very simple. A woman filed a sexual harassment case against a person who supposed to be a SC. So that's why it has come up. Maybe with the initial stage itself, they would have come that it has come against that, and the Honorable High Court rejected their appeal. If it is only a malicious one, it can be tried out under that act, or otherwise it can be tried out under the POSH Act itself. Okay, the next one is more from the Honorable Karnataka High Court. Usha Batmini and others versus State of Karnataka and others. If an internal committee has conducted a proper inquiry into allegations of sexual harassment and has found no truth or substance, the prosecution of the respondent for the very same violation based on the very same set of evidence would be an unjust and an abuse process of court. Thus, as an afterthought, a police complaint cannot be. See, very simple here, what has happened. I think the respondent was cleared off. There is no, the petition was, complaint was rejected. And because it was rejected under Posh Act, I think the complainant went into police and gave a complaint against IPC, Indian Penal Code. I think that's where Karnataka High Court rejected the petition by that individual, stating that it was rejected by Posh. Because of that, she wants to take a revenge and she had come here. So that after, as an afterthought, a police complaint cannot be made if a duly conducted inquiry has given a clean chit to respondent. See the wordings of the Honorable High Court. Cannot be made if a duly conducted inquiry. So it was very, very clearly, the internal committee has conducted a proper inquiry into allegations of sexual harassment, has found no truth or substance. Very clear, no truth or substance, meaning no documentation, no evidence against the person, and given a clean sheet to the respondent. And that's why he was being cleared out. So if the ICE is very strong, competent enough to handle any such situation of sexual harassment, the reputation of the organization will be there. Even after it went to the court, it cannot do anything. The reputation remains. Maybe it is held high. The next one, Honorable Kerala High Court, KP Anil Rajagopal versus State of Kerala, Kerala High Court, that the act or behavior must be connected with sexual harassment, including allegations of promise, threat, or an offensive or hostile environment towards her. A solitary, a single allegation of intemperate language against a female employee in a report does not constitute an offense. Maybe through a mail or maybe some note, maybe he would have used an intemperate language, that individual. For such conditions, it cannot be treated as a sexual harassment and punishment cannot be taken. That the respondent cannot be treated as a accused in under the Posh Act. That's very clear. A solitary allegation. He is not a person habitual of doing that. It is a solitary allegation of an intemperate language. The judgment is very clear. It's an intemperate language. He is not even used to anything like a word which is verbally sexually harassing. Intemperate language against a female language in a report, not even a physical one, in a report does not constitute an offense under the Posh Act. So that is also very clear. So IC can learn so many things with more and more orders from the Honorable Courts. In one specific case, Honorable Madras High Court, Ms. G versus ISG Nova Software Technologies. The Honorable Madras High Court directed the company to pay 1.68 crores as damages. This is the highest, heaviest penalty so far levied on an employer, damages for sexual harassment to an aggrieved woman. It reported that the court said in its order that if the company had set up a committee to inquire into allegations of sexual harassment, the litigation may have been avoided. So in that company, hopefully maybe IT or ITS company would have spent so much of money, but they did not have a IC committee. And what has been done, things like that, we have to go into the detail, but irrespective of that, 1.68 crore. And see the reputational hazard of that company. This has gone. Very clearly it has mentioned ISG Nova Soft Technologies. Somebody goes, Google it and the address, who will join that company? So such things are very, very sensitive under this legislation. This is also a very, very sensitive case. Honorable Madhya Pradesh High Court, Global Health Private Limited versus Local Complaints Committee, District Indore versus others, a large fine on an employer for failing to comply with the mandatory provision. This is also a very, very sensitive case, I think. So this is related to a hospital. they did not have a IC, and later they had something that they have done. So there was a large fine, big heavy money was slapped on that organization. Honorable Patna High Court, Mohan Kumar, somebody. The Patna High Court held that the disciplinary authority can dismiss an employee from the services once the sexual harassment charges are proven. So employer has the right to dismiss if the sexual harassment charges are proven. So it is not a small thing, like, you know, issue a reprimand, a show cause notice or warning letter, or maybe cut an increment. You can just like that dismiss. We see the plight of that individual. Wherever he goes, he has an experience certificate stating that he was terminated for sexual harassment, where he will get his job. I think this is the last slide, the last one. This very, very sensitive case, Additional Labor Commissioner, Bangalore. This was not reported fully, but the gist of that judgment has come out. Former employee versus IP Infusion Software India Private Limited. The State Labor Department has imposed a monthly penalty. See, what is the punishment? Monthly penalty of ₹50,000 for 5 years. Monthly. So 6 lakhs into 5 years, 30 lakhs. On a senior manager of a software company who is facing charges of sexual harassment. The department also directed the company not to promote him, give him any hike for the next 3 years. So the problem here is he has to work in the company for next two. So he has to, every month he has to feel that, okay, my money is being deducted, and he has to cry for that. Because of this problem. It is not a one time, then he will forget. No, next 5 years he has to repent himself, because of this one. So you see the kind of the punishment has given. Monthly penalty, ₹50,000. I think the employer has to deduct and give it to the aggrieved woman. As the appellate authority has held the company responsible for the violation and asked to pay monetary compensation to the woman. So I think whether you deduct it or not, the employer has to pay because of the fault of that individual employee, you being an employer, not handling the atmosphere of, to safeguard the safety of the human at the office. The employer, if the employee just like that vanished, did not work for next 5 years, 6 lakhs has to be paid for 5 years, next 5 years. It has to go from the packet of the employer. So this is how this act is very, very sensitive. People should be very responsible. That's why we have very clearly told in the initial day, first day itself, that it cannot be managed. It is not a tick mark. Just, you put a tick in an assessment. It has to be complied with very sensitive and straightforward people, and you have awareness regularly, and you should be develop the internal committee. So many things are involved. Not a very simple act. That's what I be repeatedly telling. So one second, I have a question. Okay, said very informative. Okay, that's also, I request every establishment or an employer to take care of this legislation very, very seriously, and ensure that the establishment is very safe for women employee to perform. Thanks for who are joined for the all 3 days or 2 days also. I respect your participation. Thanks for your support. It gives me pleasure that I wanted to do more. We are regularly having some sessions like this. Maybe next week, tomorrow we have domestic inquiry. Next week we are going to have PF, and we'll be having a regular continuing session across all areas of HR and payroll and compliance. Please join us and support us. Thank you. Thank you so much. We will share the session PPT. in 1 or 2 days. Please wait. Thank you. Thank you very much.